From Carolla One Studios in Glendale, California, this is the Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, Travis Tritt. With Gina Grad on news and Bald Bryan on sound effects. And now, so outraged by the pork barrel part of the COVID bill, he calmed down by watching a porno called Pork Barrel. Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Got to get on. The church is going to get it on. Thanks for tuning in. Thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you, right, Gina Grad?
That's right.
Hand Bald Bryan.
Have a great Friday, you motherfucker.
She's the best.
Travis Tritt is going to be joining us today.
Glorious.
One of Brian's all-time favorites. Bryan grew up in quite a diverse household musically, right? I mean, you got the Tower of Power
was big.
Chicago.
Boss Gags. Steely Dan was way up there. But yeah, there was an era in the probably early 90s. It was probably the sweet spot, like 91 to like 94-ish, where country music was huge. It was popular. Garth Brooks, Alan Jackson, Clint Black. And that was played a lot in my house. In addition, of course, Travis Tritt.
Well, we got some birthday wishes. We got our own Dawson celebrating a birthday today.
All right.
With a double-double animal style.
Yeah. It's a good day today.
Now, I asked you about the animal style. He said that's with the grilled onions and the sauce, but I heard Gary say grilled mustard.
Yeah, apparently Matt filled me in on that, too, that they grill the burger in mustard.
No kidding.
I don't mean to Bryan all over your point, but I think all the burgers there are grilled in mustard.
Yeah, I don't.
That's what makes them so delicious.
All of them are grilled in mustard?
The only reason I know this is because when Randy Wang was really eating his feelings about 10 years ago, this was a hot topic. So I've known about this for a long time. And it's fun to do that at home, to throw a little mustard on and grill the patty with it.
Did not know that. We have to verify. That sounds a little weird to me.
I'm pretty sure that's animal style. If you get it, animal style, they grill the mustard onto the...
I don't want to shut on everyone's point, but you can't grill mustard. A grill, by nature, the mustard would not stay on.
Oh, Jesus Christ. You put mustard on the burger, you put it on the griddle, and it tastes delicious.
But I think that's just in the animal style
department. I didn't know that. Okay.
All right. Other things to get into before we get Travis on the show. Bryan's got a health update, which will tie in nicely with Travis Tritt's appearance on the show. I was watching the Meghan Markle. Am I saying that right? Meghan Markle. I was watching her interview or some snippet of her interview or something, and she brought up the name Humphrey Yogart.
Sherman Oaks Humphrey Yogart?
Yes, Sherman Oaks Humphrey Yogart. And as you know, I had a friend that worked at Snacks Fifth Avenue.
Right, yep.
And I had another friend, Beth Ringwald, sister to Molly Ringwald, who worked at Humphrey Yogart.
Did you know there's a yogurt place out here on at the corner of Westwood and Olympic called The Big Chill?
No.
Of course there is.
The thing about the Humphrey Yogarts of the world is you have to – it was sort of like – When I used to listen to K-Rock, K-R-O-Q out here in Los Angeles, and they go, rock of the 80s. And it'd be like, you have to know. It's 1987 and a half. You have to know.
This can only go.
My kids don't know who Humphrey Bogart is. They just think it's the craziest name ever. But we used to go. It was back. It was an era that I don't think my kids will ever realize, which is when you know somebody who works at a place that sells food, you would take three bus transfers, go across town and get to them just to see if you could get some free fill in the blank off of them.
My roommate worked at a movie theater, so not only did I get to see the movies for free, this is in my poor days, he brought home the leftover popcorn, which, of course, you know, it's super cheap. They pop all the popcorn. He brought home a garbage bag full of popcorn on a regular basis.
Yeah, you think about the lengths. When I was living with a roommate where I had my ebony and ivory experience in Santa Monica.
Perfect harmony.
I had a friend named Katie who was in the Acme Theater Group. She was kind of head bartender assistant manager at TGI Fridays.
Outstanding.
But it was in Northridge, right? And the scam is I'd get my pickup truck and I would drive from deep Santa Monica to Northridge because I could go there and get the baby back ribs and the sides and everything else. And then at the end, she would just hit me with like a receipt, you know, for a beer or two beers or something like that. But it was still involved round trip. It was 2.5 hours of driving.
For $8 a baby back ribs.
Right. To say $14 or something like that. $16 in gas. So I got $14 worth of free ribs. I would, of course, head out to Snacks Fifth Avenue to find my buddy Chris, who would work the cart, get a giant chocolate chip cookie. And then we'd go see Beth over at Humphrey Yogurt's to get ourselves like – but there were rules involved. You know, like you'd show up. If the manager was around, you'd have to turn around and go home.
You don't know Dave Simpson.
Right.
Just walk in, turn around.
Yeah, if there was a line or something, you'd have to sit outside on the curb until the coast was clear. Then you could come in and you couldn't get banana or triple fudge, but you could get the raspberry or the vanilla or whatever it is. I do have a I'm not proud of this, but I do have a memory of being there at night for some reason, long after closing, wandering around on a summer night, and me and some of my friends taking a leak through the mail slot.
Oh, boy.
Into the Humphrey Yogurt's.
At your friend, Beth Ringwald.
After all they did for you. Yeah.
I think she was probably... She'd probably moved on at that point, but
you sent a message.
Sent a message. By the way, all this stuff that sounds horrible, we did everything for laughs. Like I had no thoughts about how horrible we were. We just thought, hey, this would be funny.
Adam, they've had the same owner since like '86. This could be incriminating.
Oh, no.
You owe them an apology. Let's get them on the horn.
Yeah, and a few carpet squares. No, it was tile. But they must have thought, what kind of depraved homeless junkies? It's like, it was just us. Yeah. We were bored.
Please tell me the subtitle is Here's Licking at You, Kid.
Oh, yeah.
Come
has
on.
To be.
That's some Simpson shit right there.
So speaking of frozen yogurt. Yeah.
Back to the thing started in 84. What the hell frozen yogurt place that started in 84 is still going strong today? At least in the Sherman Oaks area. But anyway, so I guess Meghan worked for the one like may have been in Westwood or on the other side of the hill, La Cienega. Yeah, but I had a weird flashback when I heard Humphrey Yogurt. Yes.
Were you guys familiar? Because I didn't realize this was like a Midwestern staple. But did you guys have frozen custard out here?
Not really.
Like, we
heard tale of it.
We had Custard's Last Stand. We had Maggie Moo's. We had all these custard places, frozen custard places.
The most exotic we got was sherbet. No. My grandfather would buy sherbet because it wasn't ice cream. It felt international. It
felt sorbet.
The poor man's sorbet.
Yeah, that was it. And then when I went to Little Italy with Jimmy many years ago, gelato was a big thing. But
I'm still waiting for gelato to make a landfall here in the U.S. I mean, of course, it's around, but not the ubiquity that frozen yogurt is.
The thing is you're not going to do better than good ice cream. All the others, everything is a kind of a lateral or down move, you know, sherbet, whatever. And if you talk to Vinny, he'll tell you, just if you're going to eat it, just go get the ice cream.
Yeah, get the good stuff.
Just get the good creamy whole cream stuff.
Well, you know what makes frozen custard superior to even the best ice cream? You know what the secret ingredient is? Egg yolks. So that's why it's so rich.
Also, it also made me long for the days, the bygone era of a uniform. I liked it, you know, because if there were some girls that were cute in high school, they were in their civvies, you know. But if you went to their work, they worked at an ice cream place or something, you could see how good they looked in their cute outfits.
That was a real tell.
Yeah, that was nice.
Hey, you guys might think I'm insane, and I'm not a dude, so I can't confirm this, but you know which outfit I think could be made super sexy if you tried with the hat and everything? Hot dog on a stick.
We were done and done. Like, they were just basically stewardesses from the 60s.
Yeah. Yes.
And the other thing, I used to just go and watch them at Hot Dog on a Stick, because if you got the chick in a cute outfit, she wore the sort of, what'd they call those tight little shorts back then? I had a
hot
pants. Yeah, they had like a kind of hot pant, that nice top, and that weird Pan Am stewardess hat. And then I'd just sit there and watch them churn the lemonade. Very sexual. You know, two hands on that shaft, working it up and down.
Stir that sugar, baby.
And I'm just churning it. Like, I would just sit and stare through the glass at the Sherman Oaks Mall. Also, as I've told you guys, I definitely applied for a job at Hot Dog on a Stick. That was actually...
I don't think you'd make the cut.
Yeah, we're looking at the outfit, like go-go boots and everything. Yeah. It was between trying to be an L.A. City fireman and being discriminated against for being white, and then trying to get a job at Hot Dog on a Stick and being discriminated against for being a male. It was a
Your
brutal...
Your privilege didn't help you at all.
Not at all. And... it was a super easy math. McDonald's at the time was paying, you know, $3.25 an hour, and Hot Dog on a Stick was like $5.75 or something. Damn. You got quite a bump for squeezing into those hot pants. And I was willing to do it.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, come on, no dudes. I don't know if you could run a business that way now, but they were just like, we don't hire dudes.
Well, Hooters has existed this whole time. So
the last bastion.
Yeah, they must be a loophole.
Yeah, but I would bet you at any given Hooters, there's 44% male employment. I mean, they're in the kitchen, maybe bartending, managing, and stuff like that. The Hot Dog on a Stick was basically a terrarium where they made hot dogs. Like, you could see all around it. It was always it was right in the middle of the mall, and there's no place for a dude in his in a sausage to hide over there on a Hot Dog on a Stick. All right. I had something that I thought was interesting. I was talking to Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew, I was talking to earlier today, said spoke to Gina about something. And I said, what? And he said, I don't know, just ask Gina. So here we are.
Okay. So
some HIPAA laws coming into effect.
Thyroid's fine. I'm just pushing a shopping cart around Ralph's, as one does in the evening, and I get a call from Dr. Drew, and I think, well, this could be very good or very bad. And he needed to tell me urgently that he was in Godspell, not Hair, and that they had this reunion, you know, this Godspell reunion, and the amazing way everybody turned out. And I said, I'd love to get together with my Godspell cast from college. And he said, Kristen Bell does a show about musical reunions, and we had a good laugh. And then I went back to getting produce.
So that was his correction.
Yes.
Thanks for
clarification.
But he sang, I sang By My Side, which is Mary Magdalene's song. He sang We Beseech Thee. So if you ever want to, you know, a little bit of a duo, you just let us know.
I will I'll circle that on my calendar.
He didn't sound up for it, though.
Speaking of Dr. Drew, there's hope for all of us, because I had this revelation when I was doing my podcast with Drew earlier today. I was reading some ad copy, and I was reading it, and I would like sort of look up, check the time or the clock and what was on the screen, and I'd look back down again, and then I'd read a little more, and then I'd look back up again. And I said to Drew, I couldn't have done that 10 years ago. I couldn't have read something. If I was looking at something and reading it, that was a tall enough order.
Right.
If I then looked up and looked at the clock and looked back down again, I would have to start over.
It would look like you'd have to drag it with your finger so you knew where you were stopping.
It would look like a word jumble to me. Like, and I was always like, well, you can't read, or you're dyslexic, or something. I am here to tell you that I learned to read out loud at the age of 45. And can do it fine now. Can read, can look up, can read, can do a teleprompter, can do whatever. Things that were unthinkable for me when I was 30. Like, literally, if I had to do some TV show and there was a prompter, it was like I would have to go over it. I've told you guys this, but I'd have to go to my dressing room and read the copy. I would always
memorize
say,
it.
I have to memorize it. I would always say, what's on the prompter? And they'd go, well, this is on the prompter. And then I'd go, well, print it out for me and let me bring it back to my room tonight before we tape tomorrow. And they'd go, it's on the prompter. And I'd go, I know. I need the 3.5 pages written, and I need to go back to my room tonight, and I need to read them over and over again so I can physically read them off the prompter. And even then, it's not going to be good. And I was that way my entire adult life. And what happened a few years ago is I started doing it more. I could have never disciplined myself to sit home and like, hey, every night for an hour, practice reading a book page and then looking up and then looking back. I would have never had that discipline. But because of repetition and because of this job I got at a later stage in life, I'm now pretty good at reading out loud. I can read copy I've never seen before. If you just hand it to me, I can look down and look up all those things that I couldn't do at all. And it's an interesting phenomenon because society goes, oh, you can't do this. But we don't do with reading what we would do with a language or an instrument or driving a race car. We would say, well, you've never done that. But I bet if you did it, and you practice at it a little bit, then you could drive that race car or play that cello. Now, I get reading's a little different because we're supposed to know how to read by the time we're, you know, 9 or 10 years old or whatever it is. But I'm here to tell you that what feels like, and it felt to me completely, It felt like it was in the marrow of my bones. Like it didn't feel like, well, if you just practice doing this a few more times, you'll get comfortable with it. Like other things, like skiing or something. Where they go, well, the first time down the hill was pretty rocky, but by my third trip, I kind of started to get the hang of it. It never felt that way to me. It felt sort of chemical or organic or something. Like you're never going to be able to do this. And I'm just telling you that whatever that thing is that you just go, oh, I can't do that. I'm not that person, or I'm not good at that, or I'm not whatever. Get some reps in. You'll get pretty good at it. I mean, it's bizarre being a human being who walked around his entire adult life basically feeling illiterate. Like I could never, oh, if you ever put me up on stage and handed me a script or told me to read it in front of someone or my, I could never do that.
But especially in the industry you've chosen, which you'd be gripped by fear on a regular basis.
I know, just from that to, oh, no big whoop. Like I feel probably better at it than most Americans would be now. And it's also kind of nice because if you do another Comedy Central roast, load up the teleprompter and you can look at the fucking teleprompter instead of, I mean, when we used to do the roast in the early days, you'd have 3x5 cards. Right. And, you know, Jimmy was always a great reader. So Jimmy would like look down at the card, start reading the card, and then look up and finish the card. You
that's
know,
a good move.
As soon as I looked up, I was done, and I couldn't look back down again because I completely lost my place.
Your evolution with reading and comprehension probably can be marked the time by the roasts. You did Hefner back in 01, you did Baldwin, what, 2018, 2019, whatever it was?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's a long time.
Yeah, so it's the moral of the story is go ahead and get some reps doing something, cooking, driving a car, playing an instrument, like whatever that thing is that you think you might not be able to do, even if it's stuff that's ingrained. Like for me, reading was ingrained. Like you can't do this. You'll make an ass of yourself. You can do it. You just have to do it.
I have one that isn't as good as yours, but one that I truly could tell you in every fiber of my being. Thank you. Being a woman who, and you don't see a lot of, you know, female board ops. You just don't. Mm-hmm. I don't do mechanical shit. I don't do
for a few straight female board ops.
Right.
Also true. And, you know, I've been in radio for a significant amount of time, you know, 15, 18 years, and I've never gone near a board. I don't know what to push. I don't know what to pot. And once I got thrown into a news anchor position. You run your own board. And I said, no, you guys don't understand. Even when I was doing the morning show and I had to come in a half hour early for the 5:30 club, they had to hire a board op. They're like, well, you should be able to do this. I've never done this. I can't should. Do it. Sure, maybe, but I can't. So I said, you don't understand. I can't do it. Well, guess what? I could do it in my sleep now. And I was terrified. And there was no way to practice when it wasn't live radio. Mm-hmm. So yeah. It can be done. It's very, very easy now that I'd been doing it for a year.
Yeah. And, you know, it's the kind of thing where unless you're forced into it, you'll never get those 10,000 hours in. And I feel the same way about carpentry. Like, there's no way. If you pick it up as a hobby or you weekend warrior, I did it for 50 hours a week for 15 years. So it's like you'll just never get that kind of repetition in. I was told that I had something to do with the Masked Singer last night.
Oh.
And Max Zapata pulled a couple of clips. I guess they're self-explanatory.
Yeah. So why don't we take a listen? So this is one of the singers from last night.
The candle feeds a flame. Yeah, yeah. What I got is a spark of thoughts and
dreams. Giant snail.
Then you pull them all together. And how I can't explain. Oh, yeah. Well, cause you.
I don't know.
You make my dreams come true.
Singing one of your favorite songs.
Yeah,
one
I love
of your favorite
some
bands.
Hall & Oates.
That's a fine song, though, right?
Yeah,
that's
actually
fine. Song,
it's all Pop Diddy.
It's no
that
kiss
is the dressing
on my
room
list.
Montage.
Yeah, it's fine.
Well, anyway, so.
That show is for people who ate psilocybin and want to just freak out, right?
Yeah.
Visually.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's definitely very visually stimulating. So
I thought that was what we had outside.
That's why we have outside, Dawson.
So now the premise of the show is everyone guesses who is that behind the mask singing. So here are a couple of guesses.
Jenny?
Yes?
You guessed Adam Carolla.
Oh!
Are you sticking with that?
That's not too embarrassing. I'm not going to stick with it, though. I'm not.
Oh.
Let me go just way out in left field here. We had Sarah Palin in season 3, so I thought maybe someone political. And then I went, oh, there was an American Eagle with Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
And there's a bear named Ted. Could it be Senator Ted Cruz?
So she initially guessed you.
Right. Sitting senator
time
for this.
That's
first
Jenny McCarthy.
Was also Adam Carolla. Are you sticking with that?
Guys, I'm going to switch it up here. Okay, I'm thinking it could be Billy Crystal.
Oh!
So both what? Nicole Scherzinger and Jenny McCarthy, upon hearing the singer in the first few seconds, went, that's Adam Carolla. And mm-hmm. then they're given a chance to change it later
Format
on.
Format question, did they both randomly guess Adam Carolla, or is there like a B or C?
They both randomly guessed Adam Carolla.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did this singer have like a twang? Did anyone else hear kind of an
There's
audible
little,
twang?
Well, we can reveal... We have the reveal of who the singer actually
is. Is it Adam Carolla?
We'll find out.
Is it Ted Cruz? The sitting senator?
I'm really confused.
Is there a body inside there?
Ow! There's something in there!
Oh my gosh! What?
Shocking.
What?
Kermit the Frog.
Yeah, Kermit
Does
the Frog
count?
Popped out of the snail. And that's like the
Chiron. It says Oscar winner.
Yeah, and this is like their big twist of the episode was that the singer was Kermit the Frog.
All right, I'm confused.
Now I got to hear it again.
If Kermit the Frog sings, Kermit the Frog has to do the Kermit the Frog voice,
right? I was
going
to say, that was not Kermit the Frog's voice.
But then how would anyone have a reasonable shot at Kermit the Frog?
they wouldn't.
They wouldn't, yeah. It's all show.
It's a goof.
Yeah.
Okay. But. Dawson does not approve.
Kermit the Frog here.
That's good.
I would do much better than that. I would have chosen Sarah Smiles.
Mm. I think it was just Smile singular.
Smile. Man.
Smile.
That's all right.
Yeah.
That's a nickname for Sarah, though. So, well, I'm flattered.
Yeah.
You never know what's going on. I wasn't watching in real time, but when I came in today, Chris mentioned. But it was confusing because I was like, who was the actual singer? And he's like, Kermit the Frog. And I'm like, that was the outfit, but then who was the singer? He's like, Kermit the Frog. Mm. But how? I guess I don't understand the game fully.
This is the second time that Jenny McCarthy has picked you out.
Yes. She's got it bad.
She's got to have something on her mind that you're going to be on this show.
Well, you know, from your mouth to God's ears, if they can clear a vehicle by the Ides of March, then there's a decent chance I could get on that show. Yeah, it's weird. And Ken Jeong is just everywhere all the time.
Yep.
Just literally everywhere all the time. He's in.
He was just in the movie with Frank Grillo.
That's right, the boss level.
Yeah, he's in every movie and every other TV show. He's really carved himself out a lovely career. Let's see. We have an interesting question on line two. Jack, 39, Atlanta.
Hi, guys.
Hi, guy.
Gina.
Hi.
I want to eat your onion rings.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, my.
Brian, love you,
I
buddy.
Have onion rings, too.
Keep fighting up that Grim Reaper.
Okay.
We got some MRI results coming.
So your hypothetical, the one I got for you, is if you were to pick one movie to be your life, which one would it be?
Ooh.
You get to play the protagonist.
I get to play the protagonist in that. All right. I'm going to go that John Cusack movie where he falls in love with that chick who's super hot and her name is in a book somewhere. And
Serendipity.
Serendipity.
I was going to say, not say anything.
Yeah, I'll go Serendipity because.
Underrated.
Underrated, nice, snowy, New York. Mm-hmm. And then he ends up with, what's her nose? God damn it.
Kate Beckinsale.
End up with Kate Beckinsale.
He's choosing between Michelle Monaghan and Kate Beckinsale.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
What a life.
The idea
is it Bridget
that
Monaghan or Michelle Monaghan? One of the Monaghans.
Yeah, if Kate Beckinsale falls through, I still end up with Monaghan, right?
That's right.
Yeah. That's a life. That's pretty good. Oh, yeah. Max Pattis made a suggestion. I'm going to go with my backup, my emergency movie is Chef with John Favreau because he's got Sofia Vergara.
As your backup.
He's done banging her and he's moved on to Scarlett Johansson.
That's right. And he just eats all day.
And you're fat.
And everyone loves him. And everyone needs a John Leguizamo to kind of boost him up. Was that John Leguizamo in that movie?
I think so. You're super famous, super well known.
Yeah. There you go. I'll go with those two movies.
Brewster's Millions is the answer, right?
Gina?
Yeah.
That's actually a good one. Brian, that's a good one, Brewster's Millions, as long as you don't have anyone sabotage it in the elevator at the end.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Or Midnight Express. I don't know. Hey, Jack.
Hey, buddy.
Are you satiated?
What are your movies?
I would choose Brewster's Millions as like the obvious answer. You know, you're wealthy. You got to spend all this money. It's fun. If in terms of like a real like deep answer, I'd probably go with Groundhog Day because think of the spiritual awakening, the growth, the transformative growth you would experience.
Mm. Mm-hmm. If I don't pick the Dolly Parton Sly Stallone vehicle, Rhinestone, I would probably have to tap into little Gina's favorite and do something like Annie and end up in the manse at the end.
Mm-hmm. I watched Radio Days last night with Sonny.
I love that.
Defiantly.
You ate the commies, the Russians, French fries.
Right. That's a good movie. I want to see Crimes and Misdemeanors, but I couldn't find it.
A lot of Woody Allen movies aren't streaming, and it's not a recent thing. I've been looking for Crimes and Misdemeanors, for example, and a lot of those you can't find. Love and Death.
Yeah, we looked for Love and Death first, and then we went to Crimes and Misdemeanors, and then we ended up at Radio Days.
You might be the only human being inspired to watch more Woody Allen after watching Pharaoh versus Allen.
You're right. I can separate a man from his art. You know what I mean?
You sure can.
Check the iTunes charts. I wouldn't be shocked if there is a few spike. Woody Allen movies on there.
Yeah. It was also, it struck me that while we were going through all the great directors with Sonny, we hadn't got to one Woody Allen movie. I'd sort of covered Albert Brooks, but I hadn't covered Woody Allen. So I was once it reminded me that he's not seen any Woody Allen movies. I thought
you guys dipped your toe you guys dipped your toe in any Hitchcock?
Not yet, but
Slow Burns.
We will get
Masterful.
There. All right, let's see. Christina, 43, from Buffalo, got a question about her husband using too much hot water to rinse out the recyclables.
Yes. Hi, gang, especially Dawson. I'm a big Dawson fan. So, like Adam, I hate waste. I turn a light off when I leave the room. I turn the water off when I'm brushing my teeth. And I'm happily married. Love my husband. But if there's one thing that's going to break us, it's going to be recycling. Mm. By the time my husband puts a can of beans, or a bean can in the recycle bin, it's sterile from having run it under 25 gallons of not just water, but hot water. And it makes me crazy. So I'm wondering, WWAD, what would Adam do?
Wad.
Christy's the same way, by the way. Nothing goes in recycling that has a speck of food on it.
It's kind of tough with the baked beans can, because that's the clingiest of all canned items. You know, if it's chicken broth or something, I'd be like, just give it a fucking rinse and throw it in the thing, get over it. But it's kind of tough.
Peanut butter containers, up there too.
Yeah.
But I have a solution. What I do is I fill the can with cold water, let it sit for 20 minutes in the sink, and you empty it, and it's pretty clean. Like, it's pretty good.
Who's in charge of taking the recycling out? And maybe it's time you got the recyclerola.
Solid.
I have to say, husband does all the garbage and recycling, so he does take it out. I'm not familiar with the recyclerola.
Recyclerola? I'll explain that to you. So here's the deal. I would say, if in fact you are in charge of removing the recyclables in this house, then do with them as you will. Like if that's your duty, if your duty is I'm going to be in charge of the one to schlep the sack of recycles out every day or every other day or however often it is, then he can be fully in charge with it. It's going to be hard to modify the behavior and have him in charge of taking it out. So I would just say, look the other way on this one. He's in charge of the kit and the caboodle. Now.
All right.
Hold on.
But
the recyclerola. Okay. The recyclerola. All right. I figured out when I was doing a TV show, I installed one in my house when I lived in Lake Hollywood. I installed one in the house that I rebuilt, my dad's house. And I also installed one in Jimmy's old house, too. First things first, I didn't like all of the beer bottles and wine bottles and booze bottles and soda cans, like, sort of filling up. It filled up too fast, the recycling thing. And then what would end up happening is we'd end up leaving a lot of the stuff on the kitchen counter. Like, this stuff is going out to the recycling. But I didn't like the memory of all the wine bottles that had been consumed over the past few days.
Shaming.
It was a shaming. It was a shaming. And then I thought, you know what? 89 to 92% of the recycling is 3.5 inches or smaller. It's not, you know, the big, you recycle the 1 gallon milk jug, but that doesn't get turned over nearly as fast as the Diet Coke cans and the beer bottles and the wine bottles, right?
Yep.
And the wine bottles are really about 3 inches, 3.5. I don't know, Max Pat, what do you think the average wine bottle is at the base? I'm just using my sort of carpenter eyes at it. It's 3 5/8. It's a little under 4. Four is too big.
Yeah, most common wine bottle dimensions are 3 to 3.2 inches in diameter.
Okay, so it's a little over 3. So I had sussed out that 3.5 was enough to get you a wine bottle and every beer bottle and every Coke can or soda can or seltzer can or whatever. So I figured out, why not have a hatch, a flume, a chute? You know, why not just fire them out as fast as they gather up? Now, most people have a kitchen, and the kitchen's on a subfloor, and the subfloor's on a cripple wall, and the cripple wall's on a footing, and the footing's on... Okay. So the floor...
The knee bone's connected to...
Right.
The floor of your...
So it's like a laundry chute, but for camp.
Nah, you're
it's
exactly what it is. There's probably some film of it somewhere, Maxipata, from...
I'm looking, from the Carolla Project.
Or something. But so what happened was, is I was like, all right, how's this work? So I said, well, you get a piece of PVC or ABS pipe, same plastic pipe, ABS a little thicker, and your kitchen. It's not going to work in every house, but, and you're probably not going to get your cleaning deposit back, Gina, so don't start busting out the stucco just yet. But if you go above the countertop in your kitchen, let's say you go up a foot, 16 inches above the countertop, you go down at like a 45 degree angle, and you can take your recycling bin outside and roll it right up to that, open the lid, then you can just keep firing until the recycling bin is full, and you never have anything building up, and the rinsing isn't as big an issue because it's not sitting inside your house. Mm-hmm. It's outside. And then I thought, all right, but I need to put my own flavor on this. I can't just have an open hole to the outside of the house. Yeah, so I went and had a design made. We probably have a picture of it somewhere, Maxipata. I went and had a thing designed. It says Recycleroll on it. I think it has the date of establishment and all that kind of stuff. It's about the size of, I would say, it's about 6 inches long and about 5 inches wide, and it's kind of oval shaped. It's made out of thick.
Is it like a mud flap?
Well, it's sort of like a flap, sort of like a hatch cover, in that it's not flexible, but it is. I made it out of copper. I think I went down, had a place in downtown make them, the place that makes like prints and engraving and stuff like that. They'll make it for you. They'll make you whatever you design on CAD, like whatever you send them. They'll just make you that thing. And it's pretty thick. It was like started off as like a quarter inch thick of copper, and then it got engraved down. And then I put a little handle at the bottom of it, and at the top I put a hole, and then I glued felt to the back of it because I didn't want to scar up the wall. What you do is you don't pull it out. You go side to side. It pivots at the top. So you just swing it out to the left side, throw your bottle down, let it go, and it falls right back and covers it up. It's pretty, I think we have a clip of it from the Adam Carolla Project.
Yep.
All right, let's
finish the Recycleroll. A device that I say will be in every American home by 2011. They said, oh, the telephone. Who's going to have a telephone? Who's going to have a blender, a toaster? They all said that about something at one point in time. All right, so.
There it is.
Do we not see it?
Oh, it showed it.
It's got to show the copper.
The cover.
The cover thing.
Okay, let me.
It may have come later in the design process.
Yeah, the rest of the episode.
Yeah, I think I had one in my house somewhere. Anyway, I put one in at Jimmy's. I put one in my house. I put one in my dad's old house. I think Jimmy dubbed it the Recycleroll, you know.
It's perfect.
And if you guys are up above and you got kids and they're going through the cans, or they got you and you're going through the bottles, and you want to fire it right into that big receptacle. Oh, yeah, we have one here. Matt, smart enough to have found
Ooh,
one.
La.
I'm holding it up now. It's stout.
It's hefty.
It's substantial.
It's hefty. It says made in the USA, proudly. It says established in 2003. It's got some trademark on it with my name on it, and it says Recycleroll, and we'll take a picture and we'll put it up at adamcarolla.com. But it's got some real heft to it. It's probably 2.5 pounds of copper. And one of the things I remember is the first batch I made, like three of them, and I think it was like $40 a piece. And then I went back some years later, make a round number two. And it was like $175 a piece. And I was like, what the fuck? And it's like, well, copper's gone up that much.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah, I think expensive. I would paint it and then sand off the raised letters, and to give it the copper finish with the solid color. I should be recognized more. I should be hailed. I think I should be hailed more.
Yeah, at least the Museum of Engineering.
Right. So the Recyclarola established in 2003. Oh, maybe we have my house.
Yeah,
right,
so
my old house.
Still.
Yeah, it's got the recycling bucket down at the bottom. I put a flap outside. Do we have it, Max Spada?
No, this is just a picture.
Oh, it's just a picture of it. Yeah.
And the kids never tried to shove anything crazy into the Recyclarola?
Nah, just the dog.
Yeah.
And the front side, I had the Recyclarola thing on there. Anyway, I would say...
It wouldn't do any good there.
Let's talk to Christina.
Yes.
Do you think your husband... Do you think your kitchen could handle... is a good candidate for the Recyclarola?
I do. We own our home. It's an old Victorian, and our the recycle bin in where we keep it is against an exterior wall. My husband's handy, so I think this could very, very likely be a solution for us.
Wow.
In the meantime, though, do you give me permission to ignore the hot water?
Yes.
It pains me. It hurts me.
What is the elevation difference between standing in your kitchen and standing out where the recycling bucket would be?
I think it would work, actually, because we have like a standard recycling, city issued recycling tote.
Yeah.
I really think this would work.
All right.
I'm interested to see the picture of it, but this could be the solution.
I've saved another marriage. Yes, it could be the solution. it's going to work.
Thank you.
Tell your hubby to get on it. And again, all you need is 3.5-inch ABS pipe. Don't get into that.
Most of the stuff we recycle is cans, like soup cans.
Yeah.
Pet food cans, stuff like that. So I hear you. And I grew up in a house with a laundry chute, and I loved it. So this appeals to me.
You're a perfect candidate. Wait a minute. Max Zapata.
Yeah.
Progresso soup can.
Uh-huh.
Oh.
Diameter. Because that could be a little bigger bore there. That could be... 3 5/8 or something like that. That could be a little.
If it's a wine bottle,
a little
heftier.
Hold on, you don't know that shit off. You got to look that shit up.
I'm looking it up to confirm what I'm already thinking.
But you got a number in your head.
Oh yeah.
You just want to make sure memory served, right?
Yeah, I don't want to give you wrong information.
You may want to step up to a 4-inch ID on that to handle the Progresso soup cans, because I think that's about the biggest bore you have to deal with. Once you get the soup can, the Progresso salad, not Campbell's, that's easy.
Oh, you're fine.
Progresso, fine. And then once you do that, everything is smaller than that. And when you do the milk jug, go fucking walk it out yourself. That's what I got to say to that. And I think it's going to cut down a lot. Oh, you got... We got Jimmy's house in the Recyclarola as well.
Yeah, so the left picture, he's putting something in. The right picture is what it looks like outside when the things drop. And then we also have like the covers of some other covers of the Recyclarola.
I'm curious.
Here.
What's this from? Nice Recyclarola. Some of those, I don't know. Oh, one's like a gas cap, like a hatch,
yeah,
like it swings
back.
And the other, oh man, this is nice stuff.
Yeah.
I'm really contributing.
Yeah. Society should be.
People say I don't give back.
To them, I say, look.
Yeah, they forget. They forget about intellectual property.
Yeah. Oh, Jeff Probst from Survivor is also a big Recyclarola fan.
Oh.
God, I had so many celebrity fans.
Yeah.
I'm in the wrong business. Should have been the recycling business. The hatch one is pretty cool because, again, that's just like a cool gas cap that flips up on an old hot rod.
Yeah, they look cool. We'll put them up on adamcarolla.com, and I'll submit this clip to the Nobel Peace Prize Committee.
Please.
Yeah.
Let me first hit Simply Safe. If you got 30 minutes, then you never have to worry about home break-ins ever again, and that's how quick you can set up your security system. It's easy to do. You can do it when you're binging on Netflix or watching a game or listening to this podcast. We've been using Simply Safe 2Eyes for a long time. And again, when it's time to move, just peel, pull, and go on to your new home. Just go to simplysafe.com/Adam. Choose the exact sensors you need. Get the help from one of their experts. It'll get to your house in about a week, and then you just set it up. Go to simplysafe.com/Adam. Do it today. Get your custom system set up, and you get a free security camera as well. S-I-M-P-L-I, simplysafe.com/Adam. Batteries last up to 10 years. Peel and stick and get the free camera when you drop my name. All right, quick break. Come back with a health update from Bryan and Travis Tritt, and we'll do all that after this.
Adam Carolla's I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all-woke, no-joke culture, has over 1,000 five-star reviews on Amazon. Here's one.
Completely on point and completely relevant for today. Jack and Ward showing us that something same. Physics, see, Uncle Bean and Uncle Genema.
Eloquent and succinct. Pick up I'm Your Emotional Support Animal, navigating our all-woke, no-joke culture, and leave your five-star review on Amazon. Get all the links at adamcarolla.com.
Yeah, the thing I can never figure out with Ozzy is, like, names. I think he tried to say Aunt Jemima in there.
Uncle Ben. Yeah.
Uncle Ben and Aunt Jemima.
But what I'm saying is, like, I can say Senor Pepe's.
Right.
I can say it. It's not, it's not my language, but that's the name of it, you know, quesadilla. I just
Carlos
said quesadilla.
Hernandez.
Yes, there's plenty of guys in the MLB. There's plenty of place
Roberto
kickers.
Duran.
Yeah, these are names. Just say the name. I know it's not your language, but it's just kind of a name.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Say it like they say it.
That's right. All right. So Bryan, and this is fitting well with Travis Tritt because Bryan was inspired by Travis Tritt's song, I think.
And yeah, I'll set the table for that. I'll set the table for that because I wrote the book Shrinkage about me on my first bout with the brain tumor back in 2009. And one of the first things I did when I got diagnosed in 2009, I made a feel-good playlist. You know, a playlist of songs I had over the years and just songs I needed to listen to on my way to infusions or radiation, things that I knew, you know, times that I knew I needed a little pick me up. And I really do think Travis Tritt's It's a Great Day to Be Alive was the first song I thought of and the first song I added. We've listened on the show before. You know, Dawson can play a little bit of it.
In the microwave, got a 3-day beard. I don't plan to shave, and it's a goofy thing, but I just gotta say, hey, I'm a doing all right.
Of course, the message is there, but it sounds great. It's got the uplifting feel to it. It's got a banjo in there, just that strumming of the guitar.
It's neither drink nor drug induced, no, I'm just doing all right. And it's a great day to be alive. I know the sun's still shining when I close my eyes. There's some hard times in the neighborhood, but why can't every day be just this good?
Now, I've heard this song, played it for myself or heard it in the radio or whatever, 1,000 times. I don't think I'm exaggerating. I think I've probably heard it over 1,000 times in my life. And every time I hear it, even just now, I'm brought back to that time of my life. And that'll always be a marker. You know what I mean? That'll always be a thing that brings me back. They're like, oh, yeah, I remember the feeling. I remember the feelings I had that were negative and the feelings this song gave me that lifted me up and lifted my spirits and gave me something to be hopeful about. So I'll always think positively of the song of Travis Tritt, of that, you know, time in my life, even though it was pretty stressful.
So that covers Travis, and then you have an update, right?
Yeah, so I finished my medication in December. I was on it from June to December. And as you guys could probably tell, it was pretty hard. It was pretty harsh. It was pretty rough. You know, my voice would go. Beard was, you know, beard turned not even gray. Beard turned like a sandy color. Like my hair, even my eyebrows thinned a little bit. Like I would lose body hair. It was the weirdest, worst, one of the worst experiences of my life. Thankfully, everything has been turning around since I finished the medication in early December. It's been basically 3 months to the day, and you know, eyebrows are thicker, beard's darker. I'm feeling stronger. I'm feeling stronger every day, to quote Chicago. Going to physical therapy twice a week, be able to do more things. And the doctor's like, my doctor sees this and he says, all right, well, that was a pretty rough round of medicine from June to December of last year. Let's give you a little bit of a break before we reevaluate and decide, based on our MRIs, which we take every 2 months, what we're going to do for our next course of action. And I had my regularly scheduled MRI on Monday, saw the results yesterday as we record this on Wednesday. And it was great. Great MRI, great news. The doctor, you know, was thrilled. He's like, not only so when we look at the MRIs, we look at two things mainly. I'm not a doctor, obviously, but I know enough now. We look at enhancement, which is kind of the stars in the sky, fireworks, you know, that'll light up the flares, you know, on the scan. He looked for those. Those were all gone, which is obviously great news. And you look for the second thing, which is mass effect, the literal, the tumor. The tumor, mm-hmm. You look for the size, the thickness, the brightness, the whole thing. And that was even a little bit less, a little bit smaller, a little bit less mass effect. And he was thrilled. He's like, I think the medication is having a delayed effect. You're looking better and better every time we see the MRI. So we're going to just keep going with what we're doing, which is nothing, which is fantastic. Just every couple of months, get an MRI and see where we are. But this is the best news I've gotten in quite some time, because it's number one, no, you know, treatment coming up, which is fantastic. But number two, I feel great and I'm doing great and the medicine worked. And thank you to everyone who sent, you know, well wishes, tweets. I see them all and I appreciate them.
Wow. Good. This is fantastic news.
It's really good news. You know, the doctor plays it pretty close to the vest. My doctor, obviously, he's like, well, this looks concerning, or this, you know, this looks positive. And he was legitimately excited. You know, he was very happy with the results.
Goddamn great.
And I base my excitement off his excitement.
Great. Well, I hope you celebrate over the weekend, because
that's the plan.
And you've been off the medication for a number of weeks now, or months, right?
Yeah, 3 months almost to the day.
and yet the benefits of it seem to show up in a more pronounced way sometime after you got off it.
That's what he posited. He was like, I think there's a delayed effect from the medication. And it looks like it's, you know, I mean, think about, I don't know when you.
Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah, the tumor does the same thing you do. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like the medication is running all through my body, and the tumor just has the same effect that you do.
Well, good, awesome news, and you can thank Travis in person in about 7 minutes. I wanted to play. Max Zapata had a Unprepared from OKC. This one's a little different because this wasn't a suggestion from the crowd. This was just a guy who came up, who was a rancher, who was pulling balls, right?
Well, yeah, but he was sitting front row. So this show, we didn't have a pre-approved ball puller. So I told you, just find someone in the audience. And while you're doing your set, you kind of just met eyes with this rancher in the front row. And this is kind of your first interaction with him.
It's long form, but Chris says it's good.
Because I realize, like, you guys tell me if you feel this way about dentists, you know. My thing with dentists, by the way, God bless you, you're from Oklahoma. You get to wear fucking cowboy boots. Where I'm from, you're either gay or a douche if you wear those things. But no, you're grandfathered in. He's not a gay douche. No, but I'm saying, you can fucking wear boots here. And I was like, oh yeah, I'm from Oklahoma. Okay, you do that shit in L.A. and you're like, you're either gay or a douche or both, you know. But your grandfather did. I love that about you. Well, let me say this about boots for a second. They're the only shoe where it's faster to put them on and longer to take them off, right? Because, like, a tennis shoe takes a little bit to put on, but kicks off easy. Boots, I like the idea that there's a device for taking off boots, right? See that weird boot? What's it called? What's it called? The boot? Boot jack? Boot jack or the chick with super low self-esteem? Like, that's what I like. I guess. Hey, boot jack! Don't run, bitch. You'll spill the martini. All right, now let's get to these boots over here. What are you doing that's so important that you need boots? You know what I mean? Oh, you're a rancher? Oh, you're a rancher. All right. But you're not ranching now, right? I used to be a carpenter, but I didn't wear my tool bags when I went out on a Saturday night. I was like, I'm a carpenter, but I'm not doing it now. You know what I mean? Like, you're not ranching all the time. It's a non-ranching night for you. You're fucking drinking a highball. You're eating some stuffed potato skins. There's not a lot of ranching going on. Now, to be fair, if the shit goes down and we need a rancher stat, then you're a guy, right? Like, it's like if somebody has a heart attack on an airplane, we need a doctor, you know what I mean? But we need a rancher. He should be in a good mood. He should be gregarious. We need a jolly rancher. Here he comes. Stupid joke. So we ranch, that means cattle, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How many head of cattle you got?
44 Black Angus.
44 Black Angus. Doesn't make everything about race, sir. It's pretty sensitive. It's a sensitive time. I don't see color in cattle. And we have to kill them all and eat them, or how's that work? Every 6 months. It's got to be weird caring for shit you kill. You know what I mean?
When you name it.
Oh, don't name them. You know what I mean? Yeah, you can't name the cattle. Yeah, that's feel the same way about prostitutes. Like, listen, just give them a fucking number. You're going to have sex, you're going to kill them, it's going to get too personal if you give them a name after that. Do you do anything better in cowboy boots? You know what I mean? Like, if a pickup basketball game breaks out on the ranch, I don't feel like that's to your advantage. If some guy steals one of your Black Angus, you got to chase him down the road. I don't feel like the boots are going to help you. You walk in and your wife's being cuckolded by a neighbor. I don't feel like you're going to catch up to him with those boots on. I don't think there's any advantage to wearing cowboy boots in this modern era. You know what I'm saying? It's not going to help. Like, if you drive a stick shift and you got to do a double clutch or a granny clutch or blip the throttle, it's not good for driving. It's not good for chasing assailants. Not really good for anything, you know what I mean? It's a lot of attitude. That's good, but it doesn't really age you. You know what I'm saying? Can you buy boots that are pre-broken in? Like, you know those assholes with the ripped jeans now? I was at the airport yesterday, and this bitch was wearing jeans that looked like her fucking quads exploded through them. It's like, see, essentially defiled your thighs with these jeans. Like, where's it stop? Like, hey, bitch, next time you put lipstick on, just mash it around your fucking face as long as we're fucking you up. All right, maybe I went too far with that one. I didn't even know what we were talking about.
Yeah, that guy, he eventually got up on stage, right?
Yeah, so this is actually going to be a saga. We're going to find a lot more about Rancher Rick.
Rancher Rick.
Yeah, throughout the coming days.
Well,
a lot of yes or no, sir, from Rancher Rick.
Yeah, I think he was a little more vocal when he got up when he got up on stage.
Yeah,
right?
We'll give him a mic in future videos.
We'll bring him up.
Oh. Wow.
Travis Tritt is ready to go. Let me just hit Geico here, and we'll get to Travis. Do you own, do you rent your home? Well, you do one or the other, right? And then you got your automotive policy. How about you get your bundle on at Geico? Geico makes it easy. It's a good thing, too, because you got so much to do already. So just go to geico.com, get a quote, and see just how much you could save. It's easy. It's Geico easy when you go to geico.com and get your bundle going. Travis has sold over 30 million career albums in sales. Yikes. Wow. This guy's got a lot of hits. We'll talk to Travis Tritt right after this.
Tell you one thing we all got in common. We ain't gotta worry when the sky starts falling. Don't need to panic when the Lord comes calling. Cause it's all just part of the show. When the headlines preaching impending doom, civilized people start howling at the moon. They sound the alarms and there's no good news. I tell you where we'll all go. Gonna load on up, take it out to the woods where the fish are still biting and the eating's still good. The garden keeps cranking out corn and beans and the moonshine runs cause the creek water's clean. Get the fire burning to some return. Pass a jug around and smoke one down. Making the best of a bad situation. Getting by fine in a ghost town nation.
That is Travis Tritt off the new album, which is so new that it's going to be available May 7th. And Set in Stone is the name of the album. Ghost Town Nation is the name of the song we just heard. Good to see you, Travis Tritt.
Good to see you too, Adam. How you doing?
I'm doing well. God, that sounded great.
Thank you, brother.
We were just telling an inspirational story about Bryan, who has a brain tumor, but used your music to help him along the way. And I think, Bryan, you should just thank Travis or tell him real quick about it, because we talked about it shortly before you came on, but it seems to be in poor form not to let Bryan thank you personally.
The short, Travis, pleasure to meet you. I'm a big fan of yours for years.
Thank you, Bryan.
The short version of the story for people who've heard it 10 minutes ago is when I was first diagnosed with the inoperable brain tumor in 2009, my first thing that I did was I'm like, I got to make me a feel-good playlist. I got to make a playlist of songs, just lift my spirits, make me feel good, positive, uplifting songs. The first song I thought of and the first song I put on there was It's a Great Day to Be Alive by one Mr. Travis Tritt. And that's a very important song in my life, and I want to just thank you personally for putting that out in the world.
Oh, man, thank you for sharing that story. You know, the thing that I've been most amazed about over the years is music is a powerful thing, man. It really is. You know, it becomes more than just something people listen to and just tap their foot to and, you know, dance to or whatever. It kind of becomes the soundtrack of people's lives, mm-hmm. and it took me a long time to really realize that, but, man, That's such a powerful thing, and I've heard that same type of story from so many people over the years, and I didn't have anything to do with it. The fact is it's just the power of music, and the music is very, very special.
Well, you performed it beautifully. I mean, the song may have failed in other people's hands, and you did it justice.
Thank you so very much, Bryan. I appreciate it.
I was intrigued when I was talking to my producer, Chris, yesterday about you, and we brought up racing and race cars, and I said, well, what's Travis have to do with that? And he didn't know, so I'm just going to ask you now. What do you do? What do you like? Do you run them? Do you sponsor them? What's your involvement?
I was doing a tour in 1998 that was sponsored by Pontiac, Trans Am, Ram Air. And every venue that we played in pretty much was – we actually played at the NHRA events or somewhere close to the actual tracks. And before we started that tour – I went to Frank Holly's Racing School in California and got my Super Comp license. And so I had an opportunity to not only perform at all these events, but I actually had a chance to be a part of the NHRA for that tour. And man, it was just such a thrill. I'm one of those guys like you, Adam. I have a need for speed and I enjoy, you know, just getting in something that is that powerful and having the opportunity to just, you know, test your, not only your abilities as a driver, but also to kind of challenge your ability to stay calm in a situation like that. 'Cause it's, I mean, once again, when you're behind that much horsepower and you hit that button, it's like being shot out of a cannon. And that is just such a rush. It's, there's nothing like it in the world for me.
You know, it's an interesting experiment because, as I always tell people, I don't do the quarter mile, and I think the quarter mile's been reduced to 1,000 feet,
right?
I believe in drag racing because it's a little less than a quarter mile, and the things were getting so fast. But I always tell people a few different things. First off, if you got into the most exotic Ferrari or Lamborghini or McLaren, Bugatti, or whatever, and a $4 million sports car, and some guy revved it up and dumped the clutch, and you guys took off, you know, at the end of 3 seconds, you'd be doing 60 miles an hour. You get one of these NHRA dragsters, and at the end of 3 seconds, you're doing 310 miles an hour.
That's right.
That's
right.
How crazy intense it is. I mean, you could imagine being in that Bugatti Veyron and having the guy just go from one signal to the next and just nail the gas, and you'd sink back in the seat, and you'd be screaming at the top of your lungs, and you'd be doing 64 miles an hour in 3 seconds, and this is 300 miles an hour in the same time. That's nuts.
That's like in the top fuel class.
Yes.
Super comp's a little bit slower.
Yeah.
But still, I mean, as soon as you take off, I mean, the front wheels are coming off the ground and you have no steering for the first, you know, several hundred feet. And it's, man, it is just such a thrill. But the biggest thing that they taught me when I was at drag racing school was just, you know, be relaxed. Be relaxed behind the wheel. You know, you don't want to grip the steering wheel and just be, you know, locked in like you're, you know, scared of it. You have to be relaxed and you have to be comfortable with it. And the one lesson I remember from drag racing school was they said, look, if you're driving in your car and you're trying to drink a cup of coffee, you don't want to hold it tight like this, because as soon as you hit the first bump, you're going to be wearing it. You know, it's all over you. You want to get it out there and let it float, you know, relaxed, let it float. And that's the same principle behind driving race cars. You have to be, you know, just relaxed, you know, hands on the wheel, but not gripping the steering wheel like you're white knuckling it. You know, you just be relaxed with it. But I had such a great time doing that. It was so much fun. And just being around, you know, people like, you know, all these great racers that have done phenomenal things over the years. It's just this tremendous, tremendous experience.
Well, let's tie that into music. So I try to encourage people to do things of this nature, the racing a car, something like that, because I tell everyone, for that period of time, you're really not thinking about anything other than what you're doing, which is why people like drugs and people like sex and people jump out of airplanes. I like to combine all three of those activities, by the way. For the ultimate rush. But now more than ever, you need that time where you don't remember. When I get out of a race car, I have no idea what I was thinking about for that period of time, because there is nothing to think about other than what you're doing. And when you play music, so here's the question. I can go out and do stand up and be thinking about other things a little bit as I'm doing what stand up.
Yeah.
when you're playing music, it's nice. You get out of, you're away from your thought patterns or your worries or the things that normally sort of hold you back or down or little or yeah. things you wring your hands over. But once you've been doing it for as long as you've been doing it, you can probably have two thoughts. You can probably play your music and have other thoughts, or are you just completely in that moment?
I've always been laser focused on whatever it is I was doing. This new album that you talked about that's coming out May 7th is the first studio album that I've done in 14 years. And the reason for that is it wasn't because I was lazy. It was because for about, 12 years ago, I made a conscious decision that I wanted to focus on just live performance. It was very hard for me since the very beginning of my career for me to transition from one particular stage to the other. For example, if I go in and I know I'm getting ready to do an album, the first phase of that is writing. So I have to go in and be laser focused for me, and I put blinders on. I'm just laser focused on writing the best material or finding the best material that I possibly can before I get ready to do an album. Then it was very difficult for me to transition from that to recording mode, going in the studio, working on those songs, working on making the best recordings that you could possibly make. And then after that's done, then you have to transition from that to performance mode and going out and giving the best shows that you possibly can. And for me, that was always a difficult thing to do. I had a hard time with it. So I made a conscious decision about 10 or 12 years ago that I was going to focus just on the performance aspect. I was lucky enough in my career to have enough hits that I can go out and do a 90-minute or a 2-hour set or longer and have it be packed with nothing but hit songs that people recognize from beginning to end. And I really just wanted to focus on that. I gave up on trying to chase, being played on conventional radio and all that. I just wanted to go out and just deliver the best performances I could. And as a result of that, I had a great time. But my manager that I just hired about 2 years ago, one of the first things that he said to me when we started working together, he said, "Look, man, you've got a lot of great music still left in you. I know you do. And you've got a lot of great songs that you still can write. You've got a lot of great music that you still can record. And not only does that feed your fans that have been with you for a long period of time, but it also gives you the opportunity to draw in new fans that might not be familiar with your entire catalog." And the more we started talking about that, the more that I started to realize he was right. And then I was a little nervous about going back in the studio after being out for so long, because a lot of things had changed. There's people talking to me about, we digitally sample this or we do that. And I got hooked up with Dave Cobb, who is one of the greatest, most sought after producers in music right now. He's produced all the albums on Chris Stapleton, on Sturgill Simpson, Jason Isbell, Brandi Carlile, you name it. And I love the sound of his records because they sounded different to me. And I met with him early on, and one of the first things that he told me was, "Look, here's the way I do it. I take a live band into the studio, and we record all in the same room at the same time. And we want to get as many of your live vocals as possible while we're in there playing together, so that that energy is all it's unified." And as soon as he said that, that put my mind at ease, because that's exactly the way I've done it since the very beginning of my career. So nothing really changed. And I also love the fact that he loves analog still. You know, he loves to get away from the digital stuff. He records in digital, but he mixes down to tape the same way that I used to do it back in the 90s and the early 2000s. So it was a great experience for me all the way around.
What's touring going to be like, or what's it been like in this sort of COVID era? Have you been playing dates?
Well, you know, as everybody knows, most everybody knows, we were the first, the music industry was the first, the touring industry was the first group to get shut down. Right. And by looking at things, it looks like we're going to be the last ones to be reopened again. And if you're an old road dog like me, mm-hmm. I mean, I do on a normal year, I do an average of about 130 shows a year. And last March of 2020, we just got shut off. I mean, I was touring all through January, all through February, and then March comes, and all of a sudden, I was getting ready to go out and do a big tour with Leonard Skinner, and all of a sudden, it just got shut off. And the thing that I've found out about it is, you know, there's been some parts of it that I've enjoyed. I've enjoyed spending time at home with my family. But there comes a point in time where for me, performing is like a drug, you know, and I've done a lot of drugs in my lifetime. And the fact is, there is no drug that I've ever done that supersedes being on stage and having that ball of energy going back and forth between the stage and the audience and back again. It's just a great experience. And so I've been luckier than most. I've had the opportunity to do a few shows, not many, but a few shows here and there. And the thing I've discovered is that as much as a performing artist, as much as I am longing for that to just get opened back up again so that we can tour again the way that we used to, the fans are jonesing for the same thing.
Yeah.
They are dying for the opportunity to experience a live concert again. Because, you know, all these people in the past year, I mean, there's been a lot of folks that have resorted to doing things virtually, and that's all fine and good. But there is nothing on this planet that replaces the feeling and the excitement and the experience of being in a live concert venue, hearing one of your favorite artists or favorite bands up on stage, and, you know, you're out in the audience and, you know, maybe,
yeah,
you know, smoking a little joint or, you know, drinking, and you got your fist in the air and you're playing air guitar with the people on stage. There is nothing that replaces that. So I'm hoping that we all get opened back up real soon.
Yeah,
get a chance to do that again.
I feel you on a smaller scale, of course, but stand up's the same way. Everybody,
yeah,
I know, that's tried to do a virtual show from the Laugh Factory in Hollywood. It's like they just come back and they go, ugh.
Yeah,
shit,
exactly.
Show. There's nobody there. You got people up on a monitor, you know, with the feed going out. Like, it's just weird. It's
weird.
You lose all the energy. It just feels, I mean, I get what the plan is. We can't have people in the club, so we'll do a virtual show. But every comedian I've talked to who's done that, they just come back and they're like, ugh.
Well, you know what scares the hell out of me about that?
Including me, yes.
What scares me about that is a lot of these theater mom and pop venues across the country, theaters, clubs, you know, whatever. There's a lot of those people that, because of being shut down for so long, there's a lot of those folks that are shut down and may never come back. And that's the thing as a performer that scares me to death, because those are the places where you play. If you can't, it's great. If things open back up, that's wonderful. But if we don't have places to actually go and play, there's no win in that, you know?
Well, let me,
and that's the thing that scares me.
Well, let me ask this. So I know a lot of comedians. I just did a show a couple nights ago. It's stupid. It's like in a parking lot now. It's dumb. There's no science. It's got like a thing hanging. It's literally between two buildings in a parking lot. I don't know if you got that in the round thing, Max Pata. But anyway.
Yeah.
And then so comedians routinely what might play a large theater, but then go to a little club and work out in town,
yeah.
You know, or they yeah. might play a big theater or big venue and then go play some club.
Yeah.
Obviously when you're going out on tour with Leonard Skinner, you're playing big venues, but
yes.
how much slumming it do you do? How much playing the clubs do you do? Or do you, is there a local place? Is there a place you work out? Because comedians will go, I'm going to go to this little place locally. I'm going to go work out, and then I'll go yeah. out on the road.
Well, for comedy, obviously, it's a little bit different because as a comedian, you have to figure out what works and what doesn't. And,
right.
and the best way to figure that out, obviously, is in front of a live audience, right? So I know I've known a lot of comedians over the years that do exactly that. They go out and they work out their material for maybe an upcoming special or a big venue or whatever that they're going to do. They're working that material out early on. Before they actually go out and do those big venues. For us as musicians, it's much more about, just 'cause we don't ever know, just like comedians, we don't ever know what's going to work and what's not going to work. There's been a gazillion times that I have written a song or recorded a song. I thought, man, this is going to be a huge hit. And for whatever reason, it just goes right over people's heads. There's been other songs that I've done that I thought, it's okay, but it's not really my best work. And all of a sudden it becomes number one. So you just don't ever know. But we always have to just take that chance and just go out, and we work it out in the studio when we're recording. And then once we get the recordings done, I take my band in and we rehearse for, you know, a week or so before we go out on tour, and then just go out and roll the dice, you know, and see what happens. But it's always a little bit crazy, you know, when you're trying to release new material and just, you know, hope and pray. And really, the thing that I've found for me, Waylon Jennings was one of my greatest heroes. And one of the things about Waylon that I love so much was that his give a shitter was totally broken. He didn't care. He just went out and just did his own thing, you know. But he did music that moved him, and he felt confident in the fact that if he could move himself, he could move other people. One of my greatest quotes, one of the greatest quotes, I think, in music of all time came from Dan Fogelberg. And Dan Fogelberg said years ago, he said, when I get ready to do an album, I go out and try to find the best music or write the best music that I objectively can look at, and it moves me. And if I know that if I can move myself, I can move other people. And over time, you have to learn to kind of trust that instinct, I think.
Dan Fogelberg sung "Longer Than There Are
yes.
Fishes in the Ocean."
Yeah, boy.
the song.
Oh, good.
It'll if it catches you just right, like after a breakup.
Yeah.
Or it's raining and you're driving alone at night.
Oh man.
It'll bring a tear. It'll bring a tear out in you.
Oh yeah, that's for sure, man. So many great songs he did. Longer than there have been fishes in the ocean.
Higher than any bird ever flew. This could be my karaoke. This is when I need to bring it down.
Right.
So I start with Vehicle by the Ides of March, and now it's time.
That's great.
I start with Vehicle. I start with Vehicle. And then it's like, all right, it's time to bring it down then. That's when the lighters come out, and that's when I cover the Fogelberg stuff.
Travis, you come out to LA next, you know, opener, you know where to look.
Hey, man. You're welcome anytime, brother. Anytime.
Bust out some same old Lang Syne.
All right.
Absolutely, man.
That's the sitcom. Absolutely. The sitcom is I go, hey, Travis, when you're in L.A., you mind me opening, maybe doing about 10 minutes? He's like, oh, you're funny as shit. Yeah, go ahead. And I just go out there and do Fogelberg songs.
That's great. Perfect. Through the fall and summer. With love on our wings.
Yeah, Travis, don't try to sing. I'm doing this.
Travis, please.
You're embarrassing yourself.
Oh, the Travis show show.
I tell my wife that all the time. My wife will try to sing. And she says, I wish I could sing. And after listening to like 4 or 5 notes, I say, honey, I wish you could too.
Well, I'll do a Fogelberg, like a tight 11-minute Fogelberg medley if you come out to perform, to open. I also had a question. Now, Brian's got one, but I have one that involves your wife about a paranormal experience on a vacation cabin you guys owned that I thought this might be a decent time to get into that story. And then, Brian, you can ask your question. So what is that story?
Well, first of all, I'm a guy that did not believe in ghosts for years, man. I was extremely skeptical. But we had this cabin up on a lake up in North Georgia that we used to go to. I had it for 20-something years. And we used to go up there and just hang out. And it was supposedly, the story that I heard was that it was built around or close to or maybe on top of an old Indian burial ground. So we only used it like, you know, maybe 3 weeks out of the year. But we had some people that worked for me. They would go up before we were getting ready to visit for the summer, and they would clean it, you know. And you know how when you vacuum like carpet, there would be like, you know, the vacuum tracks and, you know, the whole deal. So we would go up and place was just clean as a pin, beautiful. And I would go downstairs as soon as we got there, I'd go around the whole cabin and unlock all the doors, you know, and do the whole thing. Well, I went in one time early on before I ever met my wife, and I heard voices in the middle of the night, and I thought that I had left the TV on in the other room. And I woke up in the middle of the night, and I heard these voices. And so I got up out of bed, and as I got closer to the door, I could hear the voices very clear, and there was at least 3 people that were talking, but they were talking in a Native American language. It was like watching episode of Dances with Wolves, you know, and watching Dances with Wolves. And I freaked out, man. I freaked out.
Well, now, was this outside the bedroom door or outside the front door?
Outside the bedroom door in the living room.
Oh, that's different.
And so I opened the door up and there's nobody there. And of course, I have to go back. We decorated the entire thing since it's a cabin in the woods of North Georgia. I decorated the entire thing with American Indian artifacts, Native American artifacts. There were Native American drums, masks, everything from the Cherokee Nation to the Apache Nation to the you name it. There was the Crow. There was all these different things that I had accumulated over the years from my travels all over the country. So when I met my wife, we went up on one particular trip early on, and I walked in and I went downstairs, and the vacuum tracks were still in the carpet. The bed was perfectly made and everything was perfect. And I just opened the door. I didn't even go over and unlock the doors. I just opened up the doors just to check the room, make sure everything's good. The next morning, overnight, we heard those voices. My wife heard them. I heard them. And then the next morning, I go back downstairs to unlock those doors downstairs. And there are footprints in the carpet going from the door to the bed. Their doors was, they had one of those big Katie bar the door bars that went across. Mm-hmm. It was like French doors. Mm-hmm. So there's a big bar that goes across, and it had locks on, padlocks on both ends. Those padlocks had not been disturbed. And from the night before to that morning, there were footprints in the carpet, and there was an indention in the middle of the end of the bed where it looked like somebody had sat down and put both hands down on both sides. And I immediately screamed upstairs. I said, Teresa, you got to come down and look at this. And she did. And we had several experiences like that. And then all of a sudden, they just kind of stopped. They just kind of went away.
You didn't immediately, you know, burn the place down and run for the car or
no,
nothing like that.
Because I was still a skeptic, you know, and I still am to a certain extent.
But I'm saying, if you don't believe it was Indian ghosts, it's worse because it's drunken townies who've made their way into your cabin.
Hey, it's Travis Tritt's place.
Healthily.
Exactly. I can't explain it. But I know what I saw, and, you know, it was just one of those things. It was weird. It's very weird.
The carpet is interesting because anyone who has ever lived in one of those houses that had sort of the room where you had to kind of rake the carpet, no one went into that, you could see those footprints. And if you were in there, you were in there. But if you weren't, weren't. Bryan, you had a question for Travis?
It's quite a diversion, so stick with me here. But I was thinking about Travis Tritt, as I often do. And I remember that years ago, back in the early 90s, you did a tour with Marty Stewart called the No Hats Tour.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, I always wondered, and I'm finally get the chance to ask you, did you, that's what we would call a little bit of shade nowadays, because the subtext, whether you want to admit it or not, is, you know, fake cowboys, the guys putting on the hat and doing the act and, you know, the styles of the day. Did you ever get any blowback from that? Because it was a little bit of a thumb in the nose at maybe some of the, you know, fake cowboys of the day.
Well, first of all, when you are breaking into the business, you want to establish yourself as something different than everybody else. And keep in mind, I was part of the country music class of 89, which was Garth Brooks, Clint Black, and Alan Jackson. And the four of us were labeled as the class of 89 because we all released our first singles that same year in country music. And they all wore cowboy hats, and I was the total opposite of that because those guys, musically, they were, for the most part, very straightforward, very traditional, you know, and I love traditional country music. I mean, I'm a George Jones, Merle Haggard fan. That's my center. But I also grew up loving, you know, Lynyrd Skynyrd, the Allman Brothers, the Marshall Tucker Band, Charlie Daniels, Hank Williams Jr. I loved that music. And I also loved blues growing up. I loved Ray Charles. I loved Muddy Waters. I loved B.B. King.
Dan Fogelberg. All the great blues.
All greats.
Right, the Godfather.
When you've loved and lost like Dan. the blues just comes out. You don't exactly. You don't sit down and write
truly.
It.
You truly. Drink a toast to innocence.
That's yeah, right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
The greatest blues singer ever.
But I always tried to, from the very beginning, establish myself as being more than just a straightforward. This is not your father's or your grandfather's country music. This is what I want to do to show all of my influences. And as part of that, I mean, instead of wearing a cowboy hat, I mean, first of all, these guys were all clean cut, man. They wore starch pressed cowboy shirts every time you saw them. They had on the something I'd never seen done before. They starched and pressed their blue jeans. I'd never seen that done before.
The patterns and the colors of that era were just obnoxious.
Oh, they yeah. And meanwhile, I've got hair down to about right here. I'm wearing leather on stage because I was simply the product of the places I've been playing. I'd been playing biker bars, pool halls, bowling alleys, honky tonks, juke joints, all these places. And I knew that that was my audience. That was the people that were following me. And so I was a little bit different, and I was trying to establish that difference between me and some of the other people that were my contemporaries at the time. And what better way to do that than to just say, look, you guys can wear your cowboy hats. That's all good. But I don't wear one. And there were people at the time, I think, if I'm not mistaken, I think Garth Brooks came out. He did a press conference back in those days. And I love Garth. I mean, I love what he does and I love what he's created. But Garth did a press conference back then and he was even confused. He was like, what are Travis and Marty trying to say? They don't want people with cowboy hats there. And it's like, no. Dude, you missed the message. The message is that we love cowboys. I mean, you know, I love cowboys, cowgirls, people that grow up in that environment. I did a little bit of that too when I was young, you know, being involved in like rodeo and you know, the national finals rodeo stuff. I mean, it wasn't about that. It was about trying to separate myself and make a statement about I am country, but I've got these other influences too, and I want you to see what they are. And it was meant for the audience. It wasn't trying to make any kind of a statement necessarily, other than here I am, but I'm a little bit different than some of my contemporaries out there.
Well, ironically, what's more punk rock than being a huge country star who won't wear a cowboy hat?
There you go. You know, and you know, that is a great point because the similarities between punk rock and country in a lot of ways are very, very similar in that punk rock was just about going out and doing whatever the hell you wanted to do and being true to that, being true to your audience, being true to yourself. And I was trying to do country music that was true to all of the influences that I had. You know, there's an old saying that Harlan Howard, one of the greatest country music songwriters of all time, he coined it years ago. It's country music is three chords and the truth. And really, that applies to a lot of the punk music that came out back in the early days. It's just three chords and the truth, you know? We're just telling you the truth as we see it. And so I got a little bit of flack for that, but the fans really, you know, pulled me through all of that, you know?
Engineer Dawson has a question for you.
Hey, Travis. Yes. I had some tickets to come out and see you last year at the Thousand Oaks Civic Arts Auditorium. I hope that does get rescheduled when shows come back up. But building off of what Bryan said and the No Hat Tour and your work with Marty Stewart, you know, Marty plays a big part in the song Here's a Quarter. When you do that live now, is there someone else in your band who sings that secondary part, or do you take the whole song yourself?
If I think you're talking about Whiskey Ain't Working.
I'm sorry, Whiskey Ain't Working, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I do it by myself all the way through. And, of course, every time that I get a chance to work with Marty, I always look forward to that. We don't get a chance to do it very much these days. But every now and then, we get a chance to perform together. I did some shows back in January, February of 2019. I did about five nights in a row at the CMA Theater in Nashville, where it was just me and an acoustic guitar, solo acoustic. Wow. And I called Marty, and I asked him if he would come down and join me for a night or two, and he did. And, man, there was something about – Johnny Cash wrote about it in his autobiography, and Waylon Jennings did too. There is something about performing with Marty Stewart. Me, Travis Tritt, is one act, and Marty Stewart is another act. But when the two of us get together, it's like a totally different act. It's a third act.
Greater than the sum of its parts.
Exactly. And the people that experience that firsthand, you know, I think about Waylon and Willie. You know, Waylon and Willie were very much the same way. Waylon Jennings was his own act. Willie Nelson was his own act. But Waylon and Willie together was like a third act. And anytime you get a chance to do that, perform that way, or record that way, it brings something really special, I think, for the not only for the artists, but for the fans as well. So yeah, I do the song. Obviously, that's one of the big hits.
That's
I don't think they'd
yeah.
let me out of the building if I didn't do mm-hmm. Whiskey Ain't Working every night, you know? But I do it by myself most of the time. But anytime I get a chance to do it with Marty, that's just like gravy on top of it. It's icing on the cake.
The album is set in stone. It's going to be available May 7th. And you can shoot him a tweet at Travis Tritt if you like, and website Travis Tritt as well. Yeah, I hope you come back and make up that show. Did you say that was Thousand Oaks?
Yeah.
Because I'd definitely like to go out there and say hi and see you.
Man, let me tell you something. As far as all the shows that got canceled or delayed or postponed, we are sitting on G waiting on O. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
We are just waiting, chomping at the bit to get back out there and start bringing the music back out. And I can't wait for that opportunity. I hope everybody – I know there's been some people that have been a little bit discouraged and a little bit put off by the fact that, you know, shows that have been scheduled have been either delayed. And some of them have been, quite frankly, some of them have been postponed to another date and then postponed again. And then some of them have been postponed again. But we as artists, speaking for me, and I know a lot of friends of mine, we are just anxiously awaiting an opportunity to go back into these individual cities and venues and just start playing the music back again. And we're not looking for a new normal. We're looking for normal.
Travis Tritt, thank you very much, Travis. And we'll see you in Thousand Oaks, God willing, as soon as we can.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Adam. I appreciate it.
All right. We will take ourselves a quick break. We'll come back with Gina in the news right after this.
Give me the news with Grad. News with Gina Grad. Breaking viral. Weird crime, protest, politics. Give me news with Gina Grad. Stuff they saw on TMZ. Joe Biden. Kamala. Beat news with Gina. Gina Grad.
News with Gina Grad.
Well, I know I'm not alone here, but Travis Tritt has a new fan. That was amazing.
Everything I hoped it would be.
Yeah. What a storyteller. Just
it was gregarious and yeah, forthcoming. And
oh, that was great. All right. Well, let's stay maybe on theme, maybe a little bit. Matthew McConaughey may be thinking about running for governor of Texas. His friends think he's fully into this effort. One said to OK Magazine, quote, at this point, he needs to see an actual path to winning because he's not interested in just making a protest statement. Don't be fooled by his aw shucks attitude. Matthew means business. The current governor Republican.
I'm having a kind of a, I think my trajectory with McConaughey's it's mimicking my trajectory with Kim Kardashian.
Where
I was always like, okay, he's this kind
definitely of definitely
sexy. He's this cool stoner guy, but right. Does he really have any ideas? And I was sort of that way with Kim Kardashian. I get it. She's got a nice ass. All right. You know, when is this going to end? And then they start getting into a business and then they start getting people out of prison. And then you kind of go, maybe there's a little more there than meets the eye. And starting to kind of have that same trajectory with McConaughey. I kind of had my arms folded. I was like, I get it. He gets to play that cool guy and everyone buys into it. But I don't know. Maybe there's something there.
Well, maybe we need to have Rooster back on and ask him. It's been a while since we had his brother on.
I miss him. Yeah.
Yeah, he was awesome. Didn't he come in with Coors? Like he wouldn't. It was like his security blanket. He always has a can of Coors.
He was on brand.
Yeah.
Bag of Coors.
He had a duffel bag of Coors. Yes.
Remember that. Well, speaking of
the biggest rice I ever saw.
By the way, next week, Pete Holmes, Joe Coy, Jeremy Piven, Wayne Fetterman, Nate Bargatze. So we're going to have a good bunch of good comedians on. Sorry, go ahead.
Nate Bargatze's on, or Big Gatesy, I don't remember how you pronounce it, but he's on heavy rotation on a lot of the serious comedy channels. He's hilarious.
Yeah, he's funny.
Kanye West's campaign is under investigation by the Federal Election Commission for a couple of whoopsie daisies, multiple violations.
Who could have ever seen this coming?
Well, you know, let me attempt.
Not well-oiled machine.
The Daily Beast reports that Kanye's in trouble for accepting donations from both minors and foreign nationals. Part of the issue is how he sold campaign merchandise on his site. In total, he raised more than $100,000 through alleged unlawful fundraising practices. Like there's a kid, a 16-year-old, he dropped, $3,000. He hasn't seen his merch yet. Jordan Leibowitz, the government watchdog group Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington, said, in 5+ years of doing this, I've never come across anything like this. Because, you know, it's just a mess. I don't think anyone was in charge.
His shoes, he came out with his shoes a week ago and they all just sold out immediately. Sure. They're the weirdest, ugliest, funkiest.
Oh,
shoes ever.
Yeah. They're like cartoon ghost shoes.
I don't know. Put your foot in a shell or something. They almost look like a giant clam.
Yes.
When giant clams.
They look haunted.
Giant, you know, we were talking about how hot the Bermuda Triangle was. Yeah. Bermuda Triangle was back in the day. Giant clams had their day too. There'd just be giant clams, like giant clam shells. When's the last time you even said giant clam or saw a giant clam?
Don't say geez V.
Shell. There was a giant clam thing, and every third movie, the guy'd get his foot stuck in the giant clam shell, underneath. But that's what they look like, the giant. Show me a giant clam shell, Max Zapata. And then what happened to giant clams?
Well, I'm looking at the price of these shoes on like a third-party site, and they're anywhere from $700 to $1,400.
Yeah, I think people wait in line, and then they snatch them up, and then they sell them.
Oof.
It's weird, but on the other hand,
what are you supposed to do with those?
It's a cross between a giant clam and a Crown Royal sack. Like it kind of looks like you slide your foot in and cinch them up, like you're wearing a Crown Royal sack.
Like you're stepped in a giant puddle of jizz.
Yes, it looks like what the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man wears.
Yeah. Well, I was watching TMZ and Bieber's is wearing them already. Oh, so, you know, setting up. I don't get, I mean, is this, see, I can never tell. Is this us being old or us being square?
Well, both.
Yeah. Why do we have to choose?
We can be both.
They are ugly.
Yeah, because I just go, that looks ugly to me. Why would you do that? It's like, you don't get it. You
know? Besides being just ugly, they're ridiculous.
Right, but this is the point. You know, my feeling is are we out of Nikes? Is there nothing in the 7,000 offerings that Nike has that will not suit your needs? And the answer is I want a story with my shoes. I'm not interested in I'd get New Balance if I wanted comfort. I want a story.
Right, Sacconis.
Well, that's the other thing. Are they comfortable? Does it even matter?
Doesn't matter. That's the thing. Also, in terms of what's going on in today's United States, there's a decent chance those things could be ripped off your feet when you're walking Lady Gaga's dog. Well, Gina and Bryan seized up right when they're about to erupt at my super clever line. Wow. The comedy gods have smited me. Or smoted me. I've been smoten or smitten or smoted.
We had such a good side by side of the giant clam and the Yeezys getting.
We had the Yeezys and the giant clam already.
Yeah.
God damn, what's with the goddamn internet around here?
It's all right. At least you didn't say the wrong song to Travis Tritt and are mortally humiliated right now. So it's all right.
Did I say the wrong song?
No, I did.
Oh, you did. Sorry. Yeah. You're right. Well, the only reason that jumped into my head is because we have Travis Tritt's record. Yes, you should be disgraced. You should flog yourself.
Absolutely.
But it popped in my head, A, because I'm generally insecure, and then B, it says his album, Set in Stone, available May 7th, featuring the single Smoke in a Bar, but we played Ghost Town Nation. So
we chose Ghost Town Nation because it was a little bit faster, but I did listen to Smoke in a Bar, and it's all about harkening back to the old times when you used to be able to smoke in a bar.
It's a great song.
I was just about to play it, but we have no internet.
Again, that would be comical if Travis let me open for him thinking I was going to do stand-up, and I just did Fogelberg songs. Longer than there've been fishes in the ocean, higher than any bird ever flew. Hey, good luck fucking canceling this shit out, internet bitch. Longer than there've been stars up in the heaven, I've been in love with you. And then he had Auld Lang Syne, which is a long, weird one.
Also had Leader of the Band.
Oh, his dad. Yeah. The blood ran through his instrument.
Right.
I forgot Fogelberg. Come on, man. Those would be the three that I'll hit.
Medley. Perfect medley.
Perfect medley, right?
Yep.
Thinking about 2 minutes each one. Wrap it up. I'll talk up the song. You know, my dad, I wish he was here tonight. But I know he's listening somewhere. And then I'd roll into the Leader of the Band, which is a little bit sappy. Oh, I should tell everyone happy birthday to Emmy as well, who also is celebrating a birthday today.
When you play Leader of the Band, we could have this in the background.
I know Jim Carolla's. I know he's oiling the valves on a flugelhorn somewhere. Close my eyes, I can hear the dulcet tones emanating from that flugel. There's a young boy growing up on the wrong side of the tracks in Valley Village. Not Studio City. Not Encino. Not Tarzana. Growing a one-bedroom shack in Valley Village. But we were proud. And come home from school, walk up the dirt driveway, and I could hear this coming from the living room. And I knew that meant Mama was going to be okay. And that Dad was blown into that flugelhorn one last time. Close your eyes. You can almost hear it with me. I used to fall asleep to that every night.
Wow.
Seems about, what about this time? The neighbor would chuck a boot through the window. That'd sound like my dad backed over a pregnant cat. All right. Let me hit Geico. Do you own, do you rent your home? Well, you do one or the other, right? And then there is your automotive policy, and you get to bundle those up by taking your auto or your home insurance and putting it with your auto policy. Good thing. You got enough to think about. Geico. Geico.com. You get a quote, see just how much you could save. Geico makes it so easy to do. Visit Geico.com and get your bundle on today. Wow, I was just about to say goodbye.
Well, can't we goodbye. Wave goodbye too?
Yeah. So
yes,
long.
Wave goodbye too. Let's bring it home for Gina Grad.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Reno, Virginia Street Brew House. That'll be next weekend, March 19th and 20th. I think we've added a show there, so just go check it out. And then Jam in the Van. Well, Dawson, with Art Imitating Life, is going to be doing some stand-up there. And Loxie's going to be playing there, and Adam Ray's going to be opening and pulling balls. And we're going to have a good time. Two shows. That'll be Free Mangria and Cannabis as well, March 25th. So say hi. Nashville Zanies, April 14th, doing a live pod there. So check out those tickets. Travis Tritt, everyone. What a delight. Set in Stone, name of the album. It'll be out on the 7th of May. And until next time, Sam Crawford, Travis Tritt, and Gina Grad and Bald Bryan saying mahalo.